protester down at Occupy liked their rights a lot, but Rahm Emanuel, who lived far north of Occupy, did not. Rahm hated their rights, their jobs, and every one of their books. Now, please don't ask why. He probably just doesn't know how bad this looks. It could be that his head wasn't screwed on quite right. It could be, perhaps, that his shoes were too tight. But I think that the most likely reason of all may have been that his heart was two sizes too small. But whatever the reason, his heart or his head, he stood there in October, so angry his hair turned bright red. He stared down from his cave with a sour, grinchy frown at the happy, cheering faces below in the makeshift tent town. For he knew every protester down in the tent town below was busy now with their hearts and their minds all aglow. "And they're refusing to leave the park," he snarled with a sneer. "Soon it will be 11 p.m. It's practically here." Then he growled with his Grinch fingers nervously tapping, "I must find a way to stop them from camping." For at 11 p.m., he would later unveil all the boys and girls would be sent straight to jail for violating the park curfew, and then how they'd all boo. Oh, they'd boo, 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 boo. That's the one thing he hated, when he got constant boo, 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 boos. Then the protesters, young and old, would sit down to a feast, and they'd feast, and they'd feast, and they'd feast, 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 feast. They'd each feast on justice and the bologna sandwich, which is something that would make Rahm twitch, 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 twitch. And then they'd do something he'd like least of all. Every protester down at Occupy, the tall and the small, would stand close together and they would start singing. They'd stand hand in hand, and to Rahm this was stinging. They'd sing, and they'd sing, and they'd sing, 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 sing. But for now, he was convinced that they'd all just get up and leave. And once morning would come, the loss of their camp, they would grieve. He had no idea that all through the night they would sing. And the longer this lasted, the more Rahm thought about this upcoming spring. NATO will be here in May. I have to get these hippies out today. But how? Then he got an idea, an awful idea. Rahm got a wonderful, awful idea. "I know just what to do," Rahm laughed in his throat. He called Police Chief Gary McCarthy to give him his vote. And he chuckled, and he chuckled. "Arrest those peaceful women and men. Tell them they should stop protesting at 10. All we need is a charge." Rahm thought long and hard about it, but because they were being peaceful, this challenged his wit. Did that stop the old Grinch? No, Rahm simply said. "If I can't arrest them for protesting, I can arrest them for requesting to dare stay in the park past 11 o'clock at night. This is surely not their sight." "Mr. Mayor," McCarthy said, "I thought you knew. The Constitution is more important. This for sure is true." "Lock them up. Let the judge decide," Rahm said with a sneer. And then he said quietly, "I want this to be clear. We in Chicago are serious about our tiny little laws. So you and your police force will bring out your claws. We'll make them sorry they ever stepped foot in that park." And with that, McCarthy and Emanuel were ready to make their mark. Fast forward to 11 o'clock that night. It's when the CPD wanted to give them a fright. "The park is closing now," they said to the fest. "If you don't leave now, you'll be subject to arrest." But the protesters held their ground, so they took them away. "These are my First Amendment rights you're violating," they would say. Early the next morning, Rahm Emanuel awoke, expecting the whole occupation to choke. "They'll be done with it now, since they went to jail for the night." But this had the exact opposite effect. It did not cause a single fright. They came back even stronger than before, and Rahm Emanuel surely thought, "This is war. This is war, 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 war." "Why, Rahm Emanuel, can't you see? We're just trying to express that your budget cuts and ridiculous tactics are causing us so much stress. Those of us who even have jobs are losing them every day. Without jobs, all of these taxes, how are we supposed to pay? The library's budget is being cut by several million dollars, and let's hope you're not a 911 caller. Dispatchers and police stations are being cut and closed too, and of course the Chicago Public Schools, but that I'm sure you knew. Just because we're not rich doesn't mean we are lazy. Anyone who says so must surely be crazy. Too bad Rahm is closing half of the mental health clinics in the city. Those people are surely delusional, and anyway, it is quite a pity. And all the while, big businesses aren't paying their taxes, but we, the citizens of Chicago, are getting screwed in our butts. But I suppose that's the price you pay for living in a city where the politics of the past and the present are not so pretty. Rahm the Grinch tried to make the city full of gloom, but little did he know in the spring the flowers of victory would bloom. The people of the city, the suburbs, and everywhere around would make sure that Rahm Emanuel would hear their sound. By bus and by plane, the protesters would assemble, which is surely enough to make Rahm the Grinch tremble. "We are the 99%, they would all shout, and we deserve to be listened to without a doubt. And for the week of NATO in May, justice will be brought to the protesters, I'd say. The mayor will be overwhelmed with how many of us come out, so many people that he'll have to listen to us, no doubt. He'll listen to the people whose homes have been taken away, and the teachers who have been told at school they cannot stay. The children whose schools are soon to be shut down, the librarians, the transit workers, and everyone else in town. In the spring, we will unite with many different occupations. We will even unite with people from many different nations. And in the end, we will win, for we have right on our side. And this victory will be shared. It will be shared worldwide. From Egypt to Wall Street, we are fighting for each other, for your sisters, your fathers, your mothers, and your brothers. And this war will be won by the 99%. Grab your sleeping bags, your boots, and even your tents. We will occupy Chicago. We will occupy Wall Street. We will occupy everywhere, even your tweets. Until we get what we deserve, we will not be done. Equality for everyone. Then we know we've won. We're far from that now, but this is just the beginning. We have won the first battle. The 1%'s heads are already spinning. This spring, we will continue to be the source of their frustration. So join us on April 7th to continue our occupation.